Requisition.
In order.
Okay. So let's clear up some of the terminology, okay? Your requisition is, yes, it is an order, but is it the original order from the doctor? Okay, the original doctor comes in the form of an actual paper prescription. Okay, the patient shows up into the hospital and they present that prescription to the front desk and they type up an order. So the requisition is kind of the second part of the whole process. Okay, so the physical part of it is the actual prescription written by the doctor or the actual order written from the chart. The end result is a requisition. Now before I go any further, is the requisition always going to be right? Okay, because we're all human, right? So even those who are typing up the requisition can make a mistake. And so right off the bat, when you guys get an order to do a procedure, what do you need to do? You need to verify what? You need to verify the original order. Okay? So the requisition is an order. Okay? It is as written or ordered by the physician. And as I said, never ever perform an exam without an order. Oftentimes, as technologists, you will have ICU, you will have ER, call you, come do a stat portable chest x-ray, for example. Okay, so stat means what? You need to do it immediately. Okay, you need to go and do the procedure immediately. Now, before I even perform the procedure, what am I gonna do?
Need the paperwork?
I need to look up, okay, I get a requisition, but again, the most verifiable part of this procedure is looking at the original order. So that can come in a patient's chart, it can be a photocopy of the prescription, but just don't go strictly on what you see written or typed out on a piece of paper. You have to refer to the original order of prescription. Because remember what I said, even in case you got the secretary typing this up, it may not match up. Or sometimes what happens is the doctor will give a verbal order to the nurses to give us a call and say, you know, the doctor just ordered a stat chest x-ray. Okay? But anytime you do that, you still need to verify the order. So you need to look at the chart. You need to look at the original prescription before you perform the procedure.
Okay? So how the verbal order, you can look at it? I mean,
you can't do a verbal order.
I mean, if the doctor had the verbal order.
If the doctor was there telling you, then you can go ahead and do it. But if the doctor's not present, okay, the nurse, also with the nurse, if the doctor's giving a verbal order to the nurse, it still needs to be on the chart. If it's not there on the chart, if it's not on a piece of paper, a prescription, you cannot do the procedure. Okay? Because basically what you're doing is you're practicing x-ray illegally. Because as radiologic technologists, you are performing procedures under the guidance of a physician in the form of a prescription. So if you are doing a procedure without an order, you are performing x-rays illegally. Okay? Just like a nurse, you can't be giving drugs unless it's an order. Does that make sense? Okay. Also, this is also a good way to verify if the patient is able to talk. This is going to be part of your dialogue. Ms. Jones, I'm here to perform a chest x-ray on you. Do you know why the doctor might be doing this? Well, there's nothing wrong with my chest. Yeah, you're coughing, you're short of breath. Oh, there's nothing wrong with me. I'm perfectly fine. Okay? Because this can also be a good indicator that maybe the order was incorrect. So there are things that you need to check and double check before you perform the exam. So one is order, the other one is also making sure you have good proper patient history. Any questions? Did I give you guys the slides?
Mm-hmm.
On my gateway? You guys have this, right? Okay. So the requisition end is a hard copy or printout of the original order. Again, you want to verify this before you proceed. So, first thing you do when you are face to face with your patient is you want to, we're trying to build rapport, right? We're trying to build rapport. So you're going to identify yourself. Hi, I'm Mike. I'm from the X-ray department. I'll be performing your X-ray procedure today. Or I'll be taking pictures. You know, if they want to use layman terms, you can use layman terms for the patient to understand. One thing that I want you guys to get in the habit of not doing is using medical jargon with your patients. You want to keep it as simple as possible for them to follow your directions and your commands. Okay. When you start using a lot of that medical lingo, it makes your patients what?
Nervous.
Makes them nervous, makes them anxious. Okay? So I'm not saying to dumb it down, but you want to talk at a level which they can comprehend what you're going to be doing. So, you introduce yourself. Now you're going to identify your patient. Okay. So what we have here are identifiers. A good identifier is the name. Okay. Mr. Nelson, nice to meet you. I'm Mike. I'm going to be performing an X-ray for you. Can you spell your last name for me, please?
N-E-L-S-O-N.
N-E-L-S-O-N. Can you give me your first name? Okay. Can you please give me your birthday?
You don't have to give it.
Okay. But again, we're trying to make sure that we've got the correct patient. Now, Benjamin Nelson, is Nelson a common name? I mean, it's a popular name, but it's not as common. Okay. What's common are names like Hernandez, like Tran, like Smith, like Brown. You guys are with me? Okay. So. You'll have a population, especially like if you're working in a community hospital where they have a lot of the same last names. They may also have a lot of the same first names. Okay, and sometimes you have names that are applicable for both male and female, like Pat, like Marion, depending on the spelling, could be male or female, right? You guys with me? So you can go with the patient's name, okay? Because this has happened. I've gone to the waiting room and I ask for, you know, you just don't go and they say, okay, Miss Nguyen. You go to Fountain Valley, how many patients are gonna stand up with that last name? It's a common last name. So you're going to have four or five patients standing up. Now how are you going to eliminate the remaining four or five? And you're going to say, now you're going to say their first name. Hopefully you pronounce it right. Okay? And then also you're looking at your requisition. Your requisition is also going to tell you the gender, male or female. Now is that always a good identifier? Nowadays, is it? No. Okay, so that's another identifier that's kind of hard to follow. Birthday you can go with. Social security number you can go with. Okay, but these are just some examples because you want to make sure you've got the correct patient. Okay, so unacceptable identifiers include gender, religion, ethnicity, height, weight, etc., etc. These are the most common types of identifiers for correct patient. Now in your dialogue, again, this is what we're going to practice in role play. You're going to introduce yourself, you're going to ask them for their name, you're going to ask them for the spelling, you're going to ask them for the birthday. Okay, those are the common identifiers. And we'll practice that over and over again in our lab. Okay? And now you're going to give a general explanation of the procedure. We're going from the very general to the specific. So, after you identified yourself, and after they've identified themselves, you're going to ask them what they're here for, or what kind of procedure they're having. We know what they're having, right? We know what they're having, but what am I doing again? I'm making sure that I've got the right patient by them telling me what type of procedure they're gonna have. Mr. Nelson, what are you here for? Chest x-ray. Oh yeah, it says right here, chest x-ray. My requisition says chest. So far, we're right on the same line. Okay? So they say I'm here for a chest x-ray. Then you're gonna say, okay, what kind of problems are you having? Is this for me to know? Do I want to know what kind of problems he's having? Is it for my own personal benefit? Who is it for? It's for the doctor. Okay, it's the doctor who's going to be reading the radiographs, reading the images. Because the more information that you give the physician who's reading the radiographs, the better, it's kind of like the GPS. You're trying to pinpoint an area so that the doctor can focus on that specific area in making his or her proper diagnosis. So how long have you had this problem? What kind of problems have you been having? I've had this cough. For how long? Okay, 2 weeks. Now, are you memorizing all this or are you putting it down on the patient's chart? There's some writing involved, guys. There's gonna be a lot of writing. So you're putting down patient's history on the patient's requisition or chart. You're doing your chart, some charting yourself, okay? So, okay, you've been having this cough for 2 weeks. Are you having any type of pain? Okay, it's just a general chest pain. Or they'll say, oh, I kind of have a pain right here on this side, okay? And as you're describing it, are you gonna write it down in your requisition? Anterior chest pain, left side, something to that effect, okay? All right, so now that you've got good proper history, so we're verifying the order, we're obtaining good patient history, what we're also doing here is building rapport, okay? Patients are very nervous, they're very anxious when they come to the department, and what you're trying to do is you're trying to minimize that type of nerve so that you can go through the procedure without any kind of problems, okay? The better rapport that you have with these patients, the easier and smoother the procedure is gonna go, okay? Now, what about if they're in a lot of pain? Are they gonna be able to listen to you and follow your directions? Probably not. So you have to do your very best to also to try to expedite the procedure as best as possible, okay? So again, don't want to rush, because when you rush, is there a likelihood of you guys making a mistake, okay? And we say this over and over again, you don't want mistakes. This in the lab is where you want to practice, okay, get into good habits. We want you to make your mistakes here, but now on the field. But are you still gonna make mistakes out in the field? Yes, but we're trying to get you guys so you have minimal mistakes. What do I mean by mistakes? What is the end result of a mistake?
Repeating.
You gotta repeat. Okay? You gotta repeat. So that now that means more radiation for the patient. Does that also mean possible more radiation for you?
Yep.
Yeah. Because you work in that type of environment. So any repeat is bad for the patient, it's bad for you guys. Okay, so if the patient was coming down to your department, what I would do first, and again, you guys will learn your good practices and good habits when you start your clinical externship, and as the veteran technologists are telling you what to do, one of the good practices that I've done is, before I even get my patient out of the waiting room, I'm gonna look at my requisition and run through my head, what is it that I will be doing? So when I get a requisition for a chest x-ray, I already straighten my head. It's a PA and a lateral. PA and lateral chest. So I'm gonna set up my room for a PA and lateral chest x-ray. So I'm going to pull out all my image receptors that I need. I know with the chest x-ray, I will generally need 2 14 by 17 cassettes. 14 by 17%. Okay? So I'm going to pull out all my necessary tools and instruments. I will clean my table. I will clean my wall bucket. I will get my gown ready. I will get any other tools necessary to do this procedure. So that when I take my patient out of the waiting room and into the procedural room, they're not going to be standing there watching me get everything ready. What you want to do is you want to get them in and get them out. No waiting. So if you get your room ready, you can get them in and get them out. Okay? So, mental review of the procedure. The necessary image receptors. Make sure you have a chair because it might be an elderly patient that might not be able to stand for a long period of time. If you're going to be doing an x-ray on the table, make sure you have a step stool available. So these are things that it doesn't seem like they're important items, but it's going to make a difference in how you go through your procedure. Your lead markers. Did you guys order your lead markers yet? Your anatomical markers, do you have them?
Mm-hmm.
You do have them, good, okay. Radiation protection, any type of positioning aids, sponge. Tape is going to be your best friend, guys. Did we mention that before? Tape is going to be your best friend. If you need tape anywhere in the hospital, who's likely going to have tape?
Rad tech.
The rad tech. And it's in their pockets. They're wearing it around their neck. It's around their badge. They usually carry between 2 to 3 rolls. They have tape. Okay. Calipers. Prepare X-ray tube, bucket, cassette, holder, grid, device, etc., etc. So not only am I setting up, you know, collecting my proper instruments and equipment, things, so on and so forth, you're also going to set up your X-ray tube, your image receptor. So all you got to do is just come in, position them, boom, next position, boom, and they're out. Okay? There is no fussing with my X-ray tube or my bucket when the patient comes in and out. Okay? You want to try to get that all done before the patient enters the room. Okay? And then lastly, once you set everything up, then you're going to select your parameters on your control panel. We do digital imaging. We have AECs in the facilities. You know what an AEC is? It's an automatic exposure control. Basically cautions you guys not to think. Everything's automatic. So when you start your clinical practice, the technologist there will have you set your own technical parameters. You're going to be selecting your MA, KV, and time before you make an exposure. None of this, pick a body part, okay, and make an exposure. You're actually going to make you think. All right. So now I have the patient come into the room. So I've set up my room. The patient's going to enter. Okay. I'm going to have them disrobe in front of me. All right. So you're already going to have your gown ready to go. If we're going to be taking an x-ray of the abdomen or the chest, we're probably going to need our patient to disrobe. So you're going to give them a gown, usually with extremities not necessary. There are certain extremities that we do where we do need them to disrobe, but usually extremities we don't. Okay, only when we're dealing with these body parts from shoulder down to the pelvis. Okay, upper femur, we'll need them to disrobe. So, Ms. Jones, here's a gown, here's the dressing room, and then I walk away. Yes or no? Should I also be explaining how to put on the gown? Is that important information?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Have you seen a hospital gown? Have you seen one? There are no buttons. There are no zippers. It's just one large opening. Okay. And if you have the patient put it on like a jacket, and they step out of the waiting room, now you have full frontal. Is that something you want? So you have to tell the patient, here's a gown, Ms. Jones. Opening goes on the back side. Okay? You can even give them two, one to cover the front, one to cover their back. okay? But you want to give them some direction on how to put on a gown. Now, when we're all, when you're done putting on the gown, Ms. Jones, I'll need you to step out. What else should I be telling my patient? Not only are disrobing is not just clothes. What else should they be removing?
Bras,
jewelry. Okay, any type of body jewelry. Okay, body jewelry comes in the form of a necklace. What else can body jewelry come in the form of?
What? Earrings.
Body piercings, right? Earrings. Okay, if I'm taking an x-ray of the face, earrings, nose rings, dentures, you guys with me? If I'm taking an x-ray of the hand, try to remove the ring, try to remove the watch. Take an x-ray of the foot. Does the foot have a body jewelry sometimes?
It could.
Yeah, it could, yeah. Well, if they refuse to remove the piercing, what are you gonna do? You're gonna write it down on the requisition. Yeah, patient refused to, but you need to explain to them why you need to remove it. Which is, if you have any body jewelry in the area of interest, you may not be able to see what we need to see. So you wanna do your best in trying to get them to remove any type of jewelry. And if they refuse, just put down on your requisition or your chart, patient refuses to move totally. Patient refuses to remove a belly ring, okay? A nipple ring. You just put that on there, okay? But they also need to understand that with any type of jewelry or metal in view of the picture, you probably won't get a good diagnosis. Yes? What's that? Braces, you can't do anything about it. So you just do your very best with braces.
Why do we remove dentures for?
If they can be removed, because there's a lot of metal in there, sometimes the porcelain can also show up as a real heavy density. So if it can be removed, better. Okay? But it's usually the porcelain and the metal and, you know, construction of it that will show up and may interfere with the study. But again, it has to be related to the procedure that you're doing. If I'm doing the jaw or maybe some kind of facial type of x-rays, I will ask them to remove that. If I'm doing a chest x-ray, is that relevant?
No.
No, there's no need to remove that. So only if it pertains to the procedure. Okay? So removal of any jewelry, dentures, bra, hair clips, et cetera, any artifact-causing items as it pertains to the procedure. You're also now going to give specific explanations and instructions regarding their procedure. The more they know, in this case, the more they know, the more they're going to cooperate with you. So you got to give them the expectations. So for example, again, going back to the chest x-ray. Ms. Jones, I'm going to be taking a couple of pictures or a couple of x-rays of your chest. Okay, a couple. One, looking at the front of your chest, and the other, looking at the side. So the first view, I'm gonna have you put your chest up on the board here for me. These are the directions I'm gonna give you. In a little bit here, I'm gonna need you to take a deep breath in, I'm gonna have you blow it out, and I'm gonna have you take one more deep breath in, and you're gonna hold it for me, so I can take the picture. Do you understand? We shall tell you, yes or no. Okay, do you understand? Okay, great. All right, so let's go ahead and put your chest up on the board. And as we're touching the patient, okay, you're also talking with them, letting them know what you're doing. Are you guys with me? You gotta let them know what you're doing. Don't just put them up on the board, roll their shoulders forward, and not have any type of conversation. Let them know what you're doing, okay? Because simply just putting your hands on the person, remember, culture, religion, gender, it can be offensive and it can be a violation of some sort of belief, okay, if you're not properly communicating with them, right? The world is a sue happy environment. They're looking for a reason to sue you, okay? Communication is key. And I reiterate this over and over again, you've got to communicate with your patients. Communication is key to avoid any type of litigation. All right, Ms. Jones, here we go. Okay, hold still for me now. Okay, hold still. Don't move. I want you to take a deep breath in. blow it out, take another deep breath in. As I'm giving my commands, I'm watching my patient. I'm closing the door and I'm still looking through them through the little peephole, and I'm watching them, because this is what happens. The moment that you step away, this is what they're gonna do. And this is why you keep your eye on them, okay, as you're leaving the room. You wanna make sure that they're following directions and they stayed in the position that you left them in, okay? So don't move, hold still, okay? Take a deep breath in, blow it out, take another deep breath in, hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it, click, and I'm gonna step back into the room. What am I gonna do? Tell them to breathe, okay? Simple, okay? But we oftentimes forget that, and you're looking at them, and now they're turning blue and purple.
Can I breathe?
Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Jones, yes, you can breathe. And then you do the same thing. Send them up for the next position, give the instructions, and again, tell them to follow the instructions. Make sure they're following your commands, make sure they're not moving, and then again, you're ready to set your exposure. Now, it's a lot of information, and that's why we do this over and over and over again in lab, okay? Because there's always these slight nuances, the little bits of the information that are gonna be the most important part in completing a procedure. It's not the big ones, it's the small detail that we often forget in the proper completion of our procedure, okay? So the position sequence is, I'm gonna position the part. In the lab, we'll also teach you guys how to properly measure the body part. What's the whole purpose of measuring the body part?
How thick it is.
Okay. Which of our factors is related to body part thickness?
KV.
KV. So selecting the proper KV is based on body part thickness. Now, what we do in the lab and what you see out there in real life will be black and white. We are giving you the foundation. We're giving you an understanding of why we do certain things. When you go out in the field, technologists will be doing things their way. Not Dr. S way, not Ms. Smith's way. It's gonna be their way, but we're giving you the foundation. So although we cover some of these factors and aspects of producing an image, you may not see this all happening out there in the field. You may see more, you may see less, okay? But it's how they do it. And then when you shadow another technologist in your department, are they gonna be doing it the same exact way as the other technologists?
Probably not.
They probably won't. That cliche, there is a million ways to skin a cat. I hate that cliche, but there's a million ways of doing certain things, okay? And as long as they can get from A to Z, whatever happens in between is not necessarily wrong. It's how they do it. Now, when you guys are out there getting your training, again, you will observe that you will have technologists doing things in a multitude of ways, okay? When you're with that technologist, you do it their way. When you're with another technologist, you do it their way. Okay, that's where the challenge lies too. Because we teach you one way to do it, and then when you go out there, now you're learning another four or five different ways how to do the same procedure. For me, I am a product of all the technologists that I've worked with. Okay, I am a product of all the technologists that I've worked with. I've taken every good thing that works with my style, and I've incorporated in my system, and got rid of stuff that I didn't think was necessary and made it my own. That's towards the end of the program, not doing that at the beginning, doing that towards the end. It's towards the end of the program where they'll be a little bit more confident and letting you do your procedures by yourself. And that's when you can start incorporating what you've learned from all this text and making it your own. Okay? So these are some of the sequences. It doesn't always have to follow the sequence, but these are the necessary ingredients to perform a good procedure. The first one here is patient position. Is the patient going to be standing up? Are they going to be sitting down? Are they going to be laying on the table? This is an example. Okay? We're going to measure the part because we need to know body part thickness to apply proper KV.